No. Well, good morning, everybody, and welcome to Genetic Genealogy Ireland 2016. I hope you're feeling lovely and warm. This room tends to be a little bit toasty, so we've opened all the windows here on the side until the heating goes off around about 11 o'clock. My name is Maurice Gleeson. I will be chairing this conference for the next 3 days. It's great to be back in Dublin, back to our past, in the quiet room where you can actually hear everything and you don't have the hustle and bustle of all those people downstairs chatting away to each other. And we have a wonderful programme for you at Back to Our Past this year, and you can see it here. You'll also find it in your Back to Our Past magazine. So that's the schedule. We also have a special little DNA test prices at the Family Tree DNA stand downstairs, where you can get a Family Finder test for $69, which is the lowest it's ever been. So do take advantage of that. We have a variety of topics at this year's conference, which range from Y DNA topics, ancient DNA topics, autosomal DNA topics, and beginners topics as well. So there's something for everybody. And it's great to have so many of the speakers coming from international parts. So we have people speaking who have come from Australia, from America, and from Sweden, and from the UK, as well as our own grown Irish talent. So it's incumbent upon me to thank our sponsors, Family Tree DNA, who have sponsored this conference for the fourth year in a row. And I also want to thank my fellow volunteers from the International Society of Genetic Genealogy, whose director is sitting here in the front row, Catherine Borge. Free to join. It's a great community. We're all passionate about genetic genealogy. Big thank you to Catherine for starting it in the first place. And let's have a round of applause for Catherine. And our first speaker this morning is Gerard Corcoran. And Gerard is the Irish representative for ISOGG. He is a genetic genealogy evangelist. He has tested with National Genographic, Family Tree DNA, 23andMe, DecodeMe, and BGI. His special interests are Irish migrations, Ireland reaching out, and Irish DNA roots. And as regional coordinator for ISOGG in Ireland, Gerard will be giving us an update on recent developments in Irish genealogy, particularly those relevant to Irish genetic genealogy. So it gives me a great pleasure to introduce to you Gerard Corcoran.
Thank you, Mark. Is this one on? And here we are. There we go there. And you're all set.
Thank you, Maurice.
Can you hear?
Is everyone able to hear? Yes, it's working. Okay.
Now it is.
Yes, okay. Thank you. My name is Gerard Corcoran, as Maurice said. My day job is in technology, and it takes me traveling all over the place. My hobby, of course, my passion is genetic genealogy. And specifically on Irish genealogy, but we sometimes extend that to the broader Celtic diaspora, if you like. Yeah. So what I'd like to go through today is some of the work we do on an ongoing basis. We do analysis of Irish surnames, Irish and Celtic migrations, Irish SNP analysis. A SNP is a single nucleotide polymorphism. We could say SNP for short. The phylogeny, that is basically the tree of SNPs. Irish surname mapping, so mapping Irish surnames to counties, to regions, to SNPs. and to the Irish phylogeny. We had a very interesting project this year. It's a culmination of a five-year project, which is the Irish DNA Atlas, and Ed Gilbert will be talking about that on Sunday evening. Another very interesting project is the Irish Traveller's DNA. There was a recent award-winning series of programs which aired on RTE, and I'll be talking a little bit about that. Irish Diaspora, this is also of great interest to us, is connecting our Irish diaspora back to its homeland. We have a Irish diaspora which is estimated to be 70 to 80 million people. Irish DNA administrators, we have an very active regional DNA administrators network in Ireland, and we're hoping to strengthen that and to work a little bit more closely in the coming year. And of course, this year is the Irish centenary, and as Maurice mentioned, it's two great events. One was the 1916 Rising, the other was the Great War, and I believe we have different presentations which talk about those two subjects. So in our Irish surnames, we produce a lot of interesting maps. This is an ESRI map. It's, again, an award-winning map. It's the geogenealogy of Irish surnames, and we're hoping to use that template, if you like, to create SNP mapping and DNA mapping analysis. We do geographic analysis, SNP analysis, surname clouds, phylogenetic mapping, mapping of the clans of Ireland, Irish surnames, the big tree, which is Alex Williamson's project to associate next generation testing with surnames, surname matching and surname origins. I'll go through these relatively quickly. You can find all of the information on our Pinterest site, which is www.pinterest.com/Gerard Corcoran. And we have about 10,000 research topics there. And we pretty much go into a lot of detail. Whenever a new paper is published, we extract the important parts of it and post it up there. And this looks at ancient migrations. Of course, the big development this year and in previous years was ancient DNA analysis. We are very fortunate in Ireland to have two of the leading labs which are involved in many of the landmark papers. This is the Pinhasi lab in UCD, University College Dublin, and the Bradley lab in TCD, Trinity College Dublin. And I believe that Professor Bradley will be talking later today on the latest developments in ancient DNA. We look at Bronze Age and particularly the Bell Peakers, because we're interested in who were the ancestors of the Irish, and we think that these were the people known as the Bell Peaker people, and prior to that they were the steppe people from somewhere between the steppe people and people from the Caucasus. And there's a lot of new papers coming out in this area. We look at the Iron Age, Celtic migrations, early Christian, Ireland, Viking invasion, Norman invasion, and then the Anglo-Saxon plantations. Each of these movements had an impact on the genetic makeup of the Irish people. And some of the recent papers, very, very exciting time these last 2 years. One was The Peopling of Europe by Brandt. It was another paper by Brotherton, and it looked at mitochondrial DNA, and one of the findings of that was the dominant mtDNA signature, which is H, which is also the dominant signature in Ireland. It sort of spread from west to east. So they associated that with Bell Peaker expansion out of Iberia. Now, there are other major papers which showed a different type of story, and these come from Hack and Allentoff and Reich. These are very, very important papers which identified the expansion of the steppe people from somewhere between the Black Sea and the Caspian Sea, going from east to west. So we're trying to sort out how do we solve this puzzle. On the one side, we find from the Neolithic, late Neolithic to the Bronze Age, there was a migration from east to west, and then at some later stage in the Bronze Age, migration west to east. And expansion from the steppes is associated with the Yamnaya people who are on the Pontiac steppe. So we had a landmark paper just the final day of last year. I remember reading it online, very exciting paper, which Dan Bradley was involved in, but was led by Cassidy et al. And they analyzed a number of skeletons who were found in Ireland, in Rathlin Island. There were three Bellbeaker skeletons, and they found, they dated from the Bronze Age. There were also skeletons found in the Neolithic period. The Neolithic ones they found, they matched the signature of Mediterranean Europe or the south of Europe, and specifically Sardinia, which is associated with the Neolithic expansion in Europe. However, the later Bronze Age skeletons, or the Bellbeaker ones, they dated to approximately 4,000 years ago. And they were a different signature. They matched the people of the steppes, right, of the Pontiac steppes. And then there was another paper which came along up till then. On here, on this one, we had identified three major components of European DNA. One was the hunter-gatherers, another was the early farmers, but there was a third mysterious component which came from ancient Eurasian, and this was the steppe component, and this is what was the major breakthrough at that time. However, there was a fourth component which was found, which was the CHG, or the Caucasian hunter-gatherer, and this had been identified with the Caucasus. And so there's a lot of new analysis coming out as we speak. The papers haven't been published, but numerous presentations have been made. And a lot of the work is coming from the Max Planck Institute for Science of Human History, and it identifies the three major expansion. This is the early Neolithic, this is middle Neolithic, and this one here is the steppe component, okay? And finally, the model which is being proposed at the moment, of course it hasn't been totally debated and accepted, is this hybrid model, which combines the Anatolian hypothesis and the steppe hypothesis. So that the thing that this fourth component, the CHG component, spread from somewhere in the Caucasus, probably the South Caucasus, right? And contributed to the Yamna, or the steppe component, and that migrated east, but another component migrated south. So this is, I suppose, the latest hypothesis. It is by no means accepted yet, but this is being talked about and debated as we speak, and perhaps, I don't know if we can ask Professor Bradley about his opinion later on. There was another major publication this year. This is the third in a series of three major publications, Celtic from the West. It's by the leading archaeologist, which is Sir Barry Cunliffe, and the leading Celtic linguist, which is Professor John Koch. And it was Celtic from the West, Atlantic Europe in the Middle Ages. This one more or less explained how Bellbeaker originated in southwest Iberia and expanded from there. So what they are saying is the Celtic language didn't expand from Iron Age Hallstatt, which is the traditional model, Hallstatt Latin, but expanded much earlier in the Bronze Age on the Atlantic facade. Okay, and these are major works. Each of the book is about this thick, contains about 20 detailed scientific papers. And so this is the latest, I suppose, on the Bellbeakers and Celtic migrations. And we have a book here, which was produced by Professor O'Marala, It took him 30 years of work. It's the compendium of Irish ancient genealogies. It's quite heavy, and it's very, very, very detailed, and it contains the sum of our knowledge, I suppose, of ancient genealogies in Ireland, going back to medieval times, but also transcribing works from oral history, which hadn't been originally written down, but which was eventually written down. And so one of our objectives is going to be to map these genealogies. These were published with dates for each of the names by Bart Jasky in one of his works. So we will hope to put these on a GEDCOM tree and then map them to the phylogenetic trees, which are expanding. It'll take about 30 years, yeah, I think. Yeah. And this is the current state of the L21 tree. As you can see, a few years ago, it just contained a few SNPs. Now it contains, I believe, thousands, and it's expanding all of the time. So we're getting more and more granularity, and some of the people like Dennis Wright and some of the other people have been doing tremendous work in identifying which is the SNP which belongs to a particular family, and we try to do that by testing known people, and so this will be a long work. Hopefully we will achieve it in 5 years. And these are examples of some of the work we did. My particular one is DF21, and our people in Munster have been doing the Munster. Nigel McCarthy has done great work on the McCarthys. The Delcash, as I mentioned, Dennis can probably tell me a lot more detail about this. The L226, IRC, the Connacht. A very interesting one is the Stuart Royal Line, which is DF41, S75, Nidalrida, and so on and so forth. Again, this is a work in progress. I think Maurice is going to be talking about it on Sunday, isn't it? Yeah. And the Irish DNA Atlas I mentioned earlier, it's a major work being done by the Royal College of Surgeons of Ireland and the GSI, Genealogical Society of Ireland, of which I'm a member. And this has been collecting DNA samples from people who have 8 great-grandparents in the same general area within 30 kilometers of each other. It's a long process. I believe that Ed Gilbert, the chief scientist who presented it earlier this week at ASHG in Vancouver, and he will present the results on Sunday here. So this is a very, very important piece of work, and we're all looking forward to that presentation on Sunday. This is another, as part of the Irish DNA Atlas, one part of that was the Irish Traveller DNA. Irish Travellers are, I suppose, a minority group in Ireland who have suffered a lot of discrimination over the years, and this is a very, very worthy project. And it was led by this gentleman, John Connors. He's famous on Irish TV as an actor in a famous series, and he's very much engaged with the traveller community. These are wonderful people, this mother and daughter here. They have masters in sociology from, they're from the traveller community. This lady here is a PhD in history in UCD. And so it was a project led by the traveller community, and ISOGG participated. The Irish DNA Atlas did the scientific work on the autosomal DNA, and ISOGG supported the Y-DNA analysis, and we tested a number of people. So what I'd like to do is just show you a small clip of an extract from the program, where they
5 years ago, cutting edge DNA research began by examining samples from a wide range of travellers.
What we've been doing when we're studying the travellers is really to try to use their DNA code to learn about the past. What we've done is to take their saliva and extract out of their saliva their DNA, their genetic code, and then we're going to compare that to other populations all over the world to understand where they originate.
So if I take a marker that you carry that arose 4,000 years ago,
yes.
So we're talking about 2000 BC here, it's actually very Irish and very Scottish.
Yes.
But this is where it becomes very unusual, because you have your own sub-branch that no one else has. Yes. I have yet to see in my own testing anyone with this branch, and when we ran you against a very large database,
yes.
So I'm talking about more than 100,000 people, you have no matches. You're a unique Y chromosome. So for something up to 4,000 years,
yeah.
There's no one linking in,
yes.
That has ever been tested.
What?
So I've never seen anything like this,
yes,
before.
Yeah.
To find something this unusual in such a studied place as Ireland, Scotland and Ireland are very, very well studied, partly because of the large diaspora in America. It's exceptionally unusual. It's very, very interesting. I really want to take this further to explore how many of the traveller McCarthys from this part of the world, from Cork, carry this type, and if we can find anyone else with it.
As I said, this was an award-winning. The previous series was an award-winning series. I believe this will also be an award-winning series. Some of the findings, the general findings, I'll let Ed talk about the autosomal ones. He mentioned it in a previous presentation that there was divergence about 700 years ago from the settled community. But on the why we saw convergence of the families clustering together in certain parts of the country, and we also found this particular McCarthy line, which didn't match the other McCarthys, but which went way back to 4,000 years. And this is a very, very interesting result. For sure, we will be following this up and doing more detailed testing on it. Living DNA is a new company which started testing. They came out of they have access to the POBI, that's the People of the British Isles Project. They are backed by a lot of the scientific community in the UK. They have already provided data sets for the UK. What we would like to do with Living DNA, but also with the other testing companies, as a sort of a citizen science community project, is to work on collecting a reference data set for Ireland. And we're looking at these are the initial results of how DNA partitions Ireland, and as it happens, it corresponds exactly to the traditional tribal territories of Ireland. So we have the O'Neill or the Ulster, the Argyll, the Breffni, the Connacht, the Mide, Tuamuma, which is Munster, Leinster, Ormond and Desmond, right? So this is pretty much corresponds to historic districts of Ireland. But what we need, and what the Irish DNA Atlas needs, and what the other testing company needs, is a validated data set which we could work with. So this will be one of the projects hopefully we will work on in the coming years, and maybe Maurice will talk a little bit more about that in his talk. And if you have grandparents who live within 80 kilometers of each other, you can go to the Living DNA stand and they will provide, I believe it's a free test. So you can have a chat with them. They have a small stand downstairs. Epic Ireland. This is a passion of mine. It's a project we've been working on for the last 10 years. In 2008, I wrote a paper to the Irish government on the strategic Irish-American review. And part of the outcome of that was that we should do as we say in our constitution. Our constitution says the Irish people will cherish its global diaspora. And part of this is to do something practical about it. We lobbied many times through the genealogy committee. We submitted a major paper to that. The government finally relented and did a call for papers for a national diaspora center. Many of the towns of Ireland, including Dublin, Dalry, Tullamore, Galway, Cork, they all put in bids. Unfortunately, it happened during the real estate crash, and the government got cold feet, pulled out. But we had a shining knight who marched in the form of Neville Issel. And Neville Issel is chairman of Coca-Cola, and previously chairman of Coca-Cola, and he was looking to, he's also passionate about the Irish diaspora, and he bought a landmark building in Ireland, which is called the CHQ building. And his half-brother, Mervyn, is running it, he's the CEO, and he kindly invited us along on Monday to have a look at it and to discuss how ISOGG and CHQ can sort of work together for the benefit of connecting our diaspora via DNA. So again, what I'd like to do is just play you a little clip, a preview of this. And Maurice, you have to tell me on the timing, all right, if I'm on schedule. So this is Epic Ireland. It's only digital artifacts, there are no physical artifacts like this. But it's done to very high quality. This is the science part of it. This is the literature part. You know, we have 4 Nobel Prize winners in the English language, and it's not even our language. Yeah, that's a quick preview of it there, and we've invited the speakers and the ISOGG volunteers along on Monday to have a detailed look at that. And one of the other things, genetic genealogy and genomics, this is the new revolution. I've been working in ICT for 35 years, and we grew every 18 months, we doubled capacity and so on and so forth. Genomics is moving much more quickly than that. And this is the new revolution of bioinformatics, but it's generating huge amounts of data. And how do we analyze that data? So we're looking at using tools to do that, and specifically IBM Watson, which is an artificial intelligence platform, big data analytics, and we're beginning to do some work with the Insight Center of Data Analytics. And this year, of course, as Maurice mentioned, it's a very important year. It's the centenary of the Rising, and it's the centenary of World War I. In both events, Irish people were heavily involved. We had a wonderful year of celebrations and so on and so forth. So again, on Monday, we will take our group along to see the GPO witness history in the Visitor Center. And this is one clip I'd like to show you of one of the events which took part. That's it. Thank you. And if there are any questions, I'd be happy to take them. How much time do we have?
We have about 5 minutes for questions. So thank you, Gerard, for that wonderful presentation. We have questions for Gerard? Obviously, we're living in a very exciting time with remembering 100 years, which is the theme of this conference.
Yes.
And I think you've beautifully illustrated that with a very, very moving presentation of Misha era.
Yes.
But we're also, so it's not just, it's 1916 centenary this year, and one of the lectures we're going to have is how they identified the remains of Thomas Kent in Cork using DNA techniques, using autosomal DNA.
Yes.
And we'll also be talking about how they identified the remains of World War I soldiers using Y-DNA and mitochondrial DNA. So there's a lot of presentations at the conference over the weekend that will deal with the aspect of where we were 100 years ago.
That's
and of course, now in Ireland, we're in this decade of centenaries.
Yes.
From 1913
up to 1921. And Maurice, I believe you'll be talking about the World War I project.
Saturday.
And I believe Michelle is somewhere in the audience, and she's our expert on World War One.
Yes, Michelle Leonard did a presentation 2 years ago.
I believe she's outside there.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of things going on. We did test another descendant of a leader in 1916, but I'm not allowed to say anything about it.
Next year, maybe?
It's not published yet. So, yeah.
Well, that's a nice taste for 2017. Question from Debbie.
I
would
just know, of course, it was meant by a terrible beauty is born at the end of that.
That's William Butler Yeats from his poem. It's a beautiful poem, and I will find it for you and send it to you. It's a beautiful poem.
So is that the new Irish Republic?
It's the Republic. I remember, you know, it's 100 years since our rising. This reminds me, you know, I go to China a lot, you know, and I think Zhou Enlai, who was the leader of the Chinese Revolution, he was asked, what do you think of the French Revolution? He said, it's too early to tell, you know, and sometimes it's a bit like that. Maybe in 200 years we'll be able to say what the outcome is.
Any other questions? We have a question here in the front.
Thank you. You mentioned Neolithic remains having been found on Rathlin Island.
Not on Rathlin. These were bell beaker. So these were Bronze Age. Were found on Rathlin. The three skeletons were found under a pub of all places.
Right.
And
what better place?
What better place? Yeah. And down in further south, in fact, there was a lady, and she was Neolithic. So we know that the Neolithic had a different genetic signature from the later Bronze Age invasions. Up till now, archaeology for the last 50 years has been saying it's been pots, not people, right? So people didn't migrate, it's just the cultural ideas which migrated. But this is firmly telling us that there were people migrating and there was population replacement.
Yeah, that was what I was trying to get at, because the mitochondrial group of the Cheddar Man in Somerset in England is U5A, and I'm just wondering if the Neolithic remains that were found here are that same group.
Yes, they would have belonged to the U, and the later ones belong to H. Which is the dominant.
So U is definitely a Neolithic. So
U
is a Stone Age mitochondrial group. That's the point, is
U,
it?
U was Neolithic, but even earlier, Mesolithic.
Question from Debbie?
Just a quick comment, actually, about Cheddar Man. Those results are actually very dubious. It was that testing was done, it was never peer reviewed, and it was at a time when ancient DNA analysis was in the very early stages. And it's likely to be a result of modern contamination. So Cheddar Man is apparently being resequenced at the Natural History Museum, but when those results will ever see the light of day, I don't know. But I wouldn't take the U5 reading as being legitimate.
Great. Well, that's a great introduction to the conference. So thanks again to Gerard Corcoran.